Alright, so this is the next section, section 9M, how a campaign is conducted. So this is just the first part. It doesn't really go into a study, but it's very important that, not very important, but it's important to know while looking at the studies that come in part 2 and 3 and all the other parts. So it's important, this gives you the qualitative information or the conceptual information of what's going on behind the price changes from the perspective of the public, perspective of the operator, the perspective of the specialist, and the perspective of the floor trader. So these parties are involved, and you have to know the interplay between them at least at some degree. So you look at a chart, it's not just a candle. You know, there's meaning behind it. Anyway, after we have determined the trend and the groups and the leaders, you know, we want to get the best stocks for our purpose of markup or markdown. And that is, we may find issues. Okay, there's times when you can buck the trend, but don't do it. He's saying don't do it until you know what you're doing. All stocks do not move in harmony with the trend. All right, it requires a high degree of skill to do this. And requires self-control and all of that. So he's saying go with the trend and so on and so forth. It is best for you to operate in harmony with the prevailing trend. Okay, we all know that. Let's continue. All right. Basically, you have to learn how to judge price, volume, and time. So we talk about Wyckoff is a judgmental method. You have to use judgment. But what does that mean? Well, part of it means that you have to learn the ability to judge price, volume, and time. All right. And this is where he gives his CM theory and does all the manipulation, the CM, and says that significant moves can be detected because they require time. So you can't detect all the moves, but the big ones you can, by saying most of the important moves in the market are prepared, executed, and concluded. And it's his business to show us how to do this. Because the preparation of an important move requires a lot of time. Basically, this is the cause and effect. If you don't have a lot of cause, don't expect a lot of effect. Or, you know, the market may just be a counter trend. Because there has to be bullish preparation. Right? Why? Because they can't buy or accumulate everything they want in one day. Why? If they do, and by day, I mean smart money, then prices will skyrocket. So they have to buy, then sell some, then buy a lot, then sell a little, buy a lot, then sell a little. And over time, so it looks like a range. It looks like there isn't too much activity because they want to quietly accumulate. And this takes days, weeks, or months. I mean, this is true, but on the intraday, you can see accumulation as well, right? But for any significant move or an important move, that requires days, weeks, or months. When he is ready to go with his campaign, he waits for a favorable market. Okay. So it's like this. He knows that, insiders know that something good is coming out in 30 days or 60 days. Okay. His operation will be timed so that the rise will culminate at that time. So good news is coming out 60 days from now. You can bet that he wants prices at the highest level in 60 days, because that's when the news is coming out, and that's when the public will be enticed to buy, and he will be enticed to sell or exit at high prices. The whole move is manufactured. When he wants to buy, what is he going to do? He advertises his stocks on the tape by making a lot of transaction, great activity, and by trading in a large number of shares, meaning a lot of volume. So volume and activity and price can be used as an advertising mechanism to create a broad market. It allows the manipulator to unload a lot of stock. Okay. He says this is just a game. It's like a game. And you just need to know the rules. And Livermore told Wyckoff he doesn't touch anything with at least a 10-point profit potential. A typical market operation. So let's go over this typical market operation. Suppose the market is fluctuating between 30 and 35. An operator knows that that it should sell at 60 in the next few weeks or months, maybe because of news. So the price is 30, he knows it's going to 60, or it can be sold at 60. Why? A lot of news or something that he already knows, ahead of time. And say he decides to accumulate, if he can, 50,000 shares of the stock between 35 and 50. So he wants to buy it between 35 and 50 and sell it at 60. First he picks up, usually it's under 50, because if he's selling at 60, he probably wants like 35 and 30. So this may be a typo. First, he picks up what he can by placing buy orders from 33 down to 30. So he buys whatever he can from 33 down to 30. All right, so price is now down in that range. Then he forces prices down to 30 by offering large amounts of stock and inducing floor traders and other people to sell and go short because stock looks weak. So it's very important. Does the stock look weak? Oh yeah, stock looks weak. Okay, good, I'll take the other side. Thank you very much. Keep selling because you think the stock looks weak. So he has to make it look weak. By putting the stock down, he may sell, all right, at lower prices of his range of accumulation. So he's ready to sell. And he will sell. So he bought... he'll sell. So you'll see the volume is high. Okay? He may sell 10,000, but then he'll buy 20,000. So his net is 10,000 long. By keeping stock low and depressed, he discourages other people from buying it. Why? It's not a high percent gainer. It's not a 52-week high. It's not a leader. It's on no stock list. All it's doing is nothing. It's inactive. The news, so it's basically irrelevant. When he is thus buying and selling to accumulate, he necessarily causes price to move up and down. So it's range-like behavior, forming the trading range or congestion areas. So the accumulation will look like a trading range or congestion area, which appears frequently on figure charts. So you want to look at those blocks on figure charts. Finally, he completes his line. The stock now stands at 35 and he has absorbed 50,000 shares below that figure. And other operators have observed his accumulation and have taken on considerable lines for themselves. So there are other operators as well. It's not just one CM. The floating supply of the stock below 35 is reduced, and that's very important. Like, there's no volume there. At 36, the stock is prepared for markup. So it moves up from 30 to 35. It's been accumulated. Then the price is about at 36, and at 36, it's at that point where it's gonna bounce. So this is gonna look like right here. It looks like the top of the base. And it looks like it's prepared to mark up. The action or on the vertical chart reveals the operator's intentions. The formation of the figure chart shows this and will be explained later. Next, suppose the above operator, by means of his own manipulation, added by favorable market conditions, been able to mark the price. Mark the price. Okay. What? Okay. So in the intervening 5 sessions on the stock exchange, he'll mark the price of the stock up with increasing rapidity, meaning he'll have a lot of speed. If the announcement is to be made after the close of the market on the 5th, he will run prices to say 56. To 60 on that day and close it at the highest point it has touched in the whole campaign with great activity and stock and large volume. Basically, he's advertising it at the highs. The close of distribution calls for much publicity so that attention of the public will be attracted to the stock. The rise to 50 started a whole crop of rumors. Brokers who are close to the bankers or the management of the company have been trying to find out what is going to make the stock strong. Insiders have hinted something good is coming out. The market for the stock is broadening. When the announcement appears on the papers that evening and next morning, many people are thereby induced to placing buy orders, and the market absorbs that morning 20,000, 30,000 shares of the operator's holdings. After, the price may reduce a few points, but he, having sold a large part of his line, is willing to take a small percentage of it back at 57 and 56. And after this has been accomplished and the activity has quieted down, he will mark prices up to 60 or 61. That might be a little upthrust there. Again, the point here, he either turns seller. At that point, he becomes a seller. So market goes up. You got your buying climax. You got a change of behavior. He brings it back down. He reaccumulates some for another rally. At that point, it may upthrust or just go into some range, and he's going to sell. At that point, he either turns seller and markets the balance of his stock on the way down, or he works it up and down in a range of a few points from the top till he has completed his selling. So he's going to either mark it down after that rally or make a range and then break it. It all depends on whether he's completed his line of selling. Has he taken his short positions? If so, just break it. Otherwise, work the range, sell the rest, and dump it. The process of working a stock up and down in a certain range means nothing to most people, but to tape readers and those who know how to interpret charts, it is evidence of important selling, and in many cases marks the culmination of the move. It will show you how it appears on some of the charts. The operator has now disposed of his entire line, and as the news is now known to the public, and many public have bought and thus taken the stock off their hands, the stock may be regarded as technically in a weak position, for it is in what is called weak hands. By this, I mean it is held mostly by those who have bought the high because of the news. And the best part about this for the operator is the public is excited, so they're gonna buy on leverage or margin. What does that mean? That means as price goes down, they're forced to liquidate their positions. They can't hold on to it because they'll get a margin call. So the margin call will be shaking them out. Why? They have, I don't know, let's just say 10,000, and they take like 20,000 or more depending on available margin. The price goes down, the broker sees the account is losing money, he calls them up and says, hey, customer, you need to put more money in your account or we're going to liquidate your position. The customer doesn't put more money in the account because he's already shell-shocked. And what happens is they liquidate their position. The broker liquidates the customer's position. So what happens then? Add to the supply. What does that mean? That means the stock goes lower. The operator now sees a chance to make a turn on the short side. So while the market is in this range of, say, 56 to 60, and after it has completed selling his long line, he sells, say, 25,000 shares. In doing this, he makes the stock swing back and forth over this range, keeping good-sized supporting orders in around 56 to fool the floor traders, the specialists, and the public, who see on the floor and on the tape evidence of support. On the floor and on the tape, they see evidence of support on the reactions. Thus, they are led to believe that the stock is still going higher. Yeah, it pulled back and it held, so it must be going higher. While the operator has sold all of his 25 shares short, he cancels all his buy orders. Why did he do that? Well, he has his orders at a certain level. People can see his orders, so they think the market is going to go higher. When price goes to the area, he's going to remove support. Why is he removing support? He's doing it because he already sold everything. He sold whatever he wanted to sell. So why keep support there? He gets rid of the support. When the operator cancels his support, the specialist in the stock then tells some of the more important floor traders that the stock is in weak hands and that there is no support. So these guys are on the inside. The floor traders are on the inside getting info from specialists that large orders have been removed from certain levels and they're not, the support is no longer there. So what are these large traders, floor traders going to do? They're going to either go short or at least remove their buy orders. Alright, so what these guys are going to do, or they can all get together and sell. So these guys rate it down to 50. That's the point the operator covers his shorts. Large charts made of the stock fluctuation during this period are shown on the next three pages. These charts, as well as those in section 16-17M, will help you understand how the market campaign develops and how its various phases are revealed graphically by charts. As you study the sections, while explaining how to interpret these records, make sure that you have the principles in mind. So all those principles that are covered here, you gotta have them in mind. So this is a point and figure chart. You know, about keeping it in a range and showing heavy selling and holding support and moving it up and then marking it up and, you know, having a broad market, right? Then selling and then reaccumulating some to take it up to 61. Then, you know, as it comes down, they think support is there, withdraw the support, market breaks. When it's breaking here, the floor traders are joining because support here was withdrawn. These guys, anyway, let's take a look at this. So D, here is the operator deciding to accumulate 50,000 shares. So D, where is A, B, and C? I don't know what the hell it is. Anyway. So D here, the operator decides to accumulate 50,000 shares. G, I can't see. Alright, here he accumulates a hell of a lot of shares at D. So right there, buying a lot. G, he forces it to 30. So after he buys, what's he doing? He's forcing it down to 30, back to support, and then buys 10,000. Up to here, the stock has kept heavy and depressed. Here he completes his line at S. At S, when it works its way up, and you know the float in this area is very little, or you know, has been mopped up. He's long so his average is about 35. Markup period is right there. Price forecasted to the striking distance of distribution level. Yeah. That's MU, the markup. Final quick forcing up in preparation of unloading was the EE. Here at 60, he begins selling. Starts selling in the climax. Stock supported at 59 until he sells 20 or 30,000. After the climax, you're having a pullback. And it seems like it's being supported at 59. And I guess down to 56. So at JJ, he buys back 5,000 of his shares and, you know, marks up a little bit. Final markup to 61. So here there was a pullback and went sideways. You reaccumulated some 5,000 shares, enough to cause a upthrust. He unloads the balance of his stocks on the way down from 61. QQ. He starts selling short. Okay, price supported. He has sold 25,000 shares. Price supported till he has sold 25,000 shares. So he's supporting, like right here, in this area, it's supporting. So you see that 58 support? Here he covers his shorts at DT. Right there. What happened, RR? Price supported till he has sold 20. Okay, so my bad. It's at here, at that support level. So he shorts after it goes up to 61. He sells. But before we go there, he sold at 60. He reaccumulated at 56. It bounces to 61. He starts selling. It comes back down to support. It's holding that level because he's still selling. And here the floor traders raid because support has been withdrawn. You know how many times this formation is available on charts? It's like you see this so many times. Even intraday you see this. Basically climax. Then after that it holds support. And you see like a little reaccumulation. Only to bounce some. Then you have some type of tightening. You know. Why? Because it's unloading. Goes back to support. Here. He's holding until he exits the rest of his line and finally breaks. That's where your hinges will gonna your hinges will be here and here. Alright, done.